KDUS AM 1060 Tempe Phoenix and KSLX HD2 Scottsdale Phoenix is brought to you by AC by J Heating, Cooling, Plumbing, and Drains.
This program is paid for by the Varsity Media Foundation, a 501c3 nonprofit educational organization, and its partners.
You're listening to the Varsity Sports Show, home of Arizona's youth, high school, college sports, and you. Empowering education and enabling dreams right here on KDUS AM 1060 in Arizona. And now, welcome to the Varsity Sports Show.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Varsity Sports Show on a beautiful late September morning, September 24th, 2022. My name is Vince DeLisio. If you listened in the previous hour, you obviously caught us on the My Recruit Show with Coach Perrone. Great show. Coach Perrone just wrapped up, and it was nice, great segments, great guests. It was a lot of fun. And now we are going to pivot, and you are part of the Varsity Sports Show. And with that, the next 2 hours, we're going to take you on a wonderful journey, an exciting journey, a lot of content. I tell people, if you miss a minute, you miss a lot. And it's not any more true than that. We're not one of those radio shows where we, you know, drag the segments on and talk really slow. So we try to avoid dead air time. We have no dead air time. We have a staff of young, aspiring broadcasters, talented, that are vying every week to submit ideas, submit content, and that's what we're bringing you today. And it's good stuff. I'm joined in studio by a couple of those talented staff members of ours. Let's start with Noelle Blumel. Noelle, welcome to the Varsity Sports Show. Welcome to the team. I know I said that a while back, but welcome to being in studio with us.
Thanks, Vince. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm excited to further my knowledge in all this, and it's been great experience so far.
Wow. Okay. Impressive. Well, we'll see how much knowledge gets further today in studio. It's going to be a lot of fun, and it'll be a pretty fast ride, I'll tell you that. And then to my left, Dylan denDekker, one of our talented directors/broadcasters. Dylan, how are you?
I'm good this morning. Wow, this is crazy. Thanks for having us on. Super excited for this next 2 hours. I'm ready to.
It's going to go fast. Yeah. So, okay, let's get a little bit of background. So this is the part we are going to slow down a little bit because our listeners want to get to know you guys. Noelle, let's start with you. So tell us, give us some backstory. Where are you from? How'd you end up? Actually, I know where you're from, but tell everybody where you're from.
Yeah, so I'm originally from Santa Clarita, California. To a typical person, I'd say LA, but then I get a person from LA, yeah, and they're like, that's not LA. And I'm like, I know, but nobody knows Santa Clarita. So just below Ventura, right above LA suburb, I grew up an athlete my whole life. I played softball for 7 years, played volleyball for 10, and even furthered my volleyball career my freshman year to the collegiate level at the University of Laverne in San Bernardino County, California. But then once the pandemic hit, spring semester of my freshman year, priorities changed, and I wanted to go somewhere with more opportunity because there were only 2,000 kids there, and I fell in love with journalism there. So I changed priorities, transferred out here to the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism, and haven't looked back since, and it's been great. I've loved Arizona.
What was it like being a college athlete and managing the rigors of academics and athletics?
I got to tell you, I wouldn't change any of my experience for the world. There are some times where I'm like, I wish I came out to Arizona earlier. But just kind of the whole aspect of being a student athlete, especially at the collegiate level, even though it was, you know, Division III, it was just as rigorous. We were up at 5 a.m. Monday through Friday with weights and games 3 days a week, managing school at the same time, and then 3-hour practices. It really humbles you. It teaches a lot about character, and it pushes you to your limits and shows you what you're capable of to apply in the real world.
Do you feel like the foundation that was laid, I know I'm asking leading questions, but it's Saturday morning. Do you feel like the foundation that was set for you at Laverne as a volleyball student athlete, a collegiate athlete, prepared you for sports journalism? I mean, what prepared you for this field?
Oh, absolutely. I think definitely just the aspect of time management and just going kind of 24/7 essentially is something that applies directly because, you know, news never sleeps, as we know. And so just kind of having that constant volleyball practice and having to balance everything is kind of the same when writing stories, producing shows, you know, calling games. It's same aspect. So I think it definitely didn't fully prepare me, but got me used to just being busy and having a full schedule.
It had to have been a tough decision for you to walk away from volleyball because it's something that you did since you were a kid, a little kid, and I've seen pictures and in your uniform. And so was there an aha moment that you said, you know what, I got to give this up. I can't do this anymore. I don't want to do this anymore. What happened?
Definitely. It was extremely hard decision, and I actually waited till the very last second to do so. I remember I sent in my application to ASU in April and didn't fully decide until the end of July, but it was definitely hard, but I had to just kind of grow up. You know, I feel like we all aged a year during the pandemic and realizing that you can't take anything for granted, and I kind of realized, you know, volleyball isn't going to be my life. My career is going to be my life, but luckily I found that out there when I was taking journalism classes. And just, you know, the overall thing of knowing that I could still have volleyball. I actually am on the Arizona State Club volleyball team, so I get to do that for fun. And so it's a nice balance, and I still get to do what I love while balancing it with other aspects of life.
All right. Wonderful. Okay, Dylan, let's talk about your background. You're from Huntington Beach, California.
Absolutely.
You are a technical director, which means that you are a software give you some praise. You're a software guru. You're into graphics. You're not necessarily so much in front of the mic, even though that's what your major essentially is, but you are intrigued by things behind the mic. Why?
I just started in high school. My passion for live sports production, my passion for production in general, has kind of just grown throughout these years of being able to call direction, having my view. I'm really a storyteller at heart, and being a technical director is just one way to get into it.
Wow. And so how far along are you in your journey? When are you graduating?
I'll be graduating in December.
I'm
super excited. I'll be graduating a semester early, doing 3.5 years at Arizona State.
Three and a half years?
Yeah.
Wow. You know, that's very ambitious. When I was going through college, they used to say the average time it took someone to get through ASU. I don't know if that's the same now, but seven. I know people change majors and things. It took me five, so I actually, you know, I exceeded expectations, but people, you know, they get into college life. You're doing it in 3.5. What are you going to do next?
My goal is to continue working in this industry and trying to find a job where I can suitable, either that's back home somewhere out here in Arizona or just somewhere.
Well, I tell you, you do a lot of good work with us. I mean, you manage a team. You are let's talk about that real quickly. You manage a team. So, what high school are you managing the football broadcast for?
Absolutely, I got Horizon Football. Great, great athletes, great team, great coaches. They've been really nice to us when it comes to game time, being super helpful with anything, any questions we have. And yeah, Horizon's my guys.
Yeah, and Noelle, you've been moving around quite a bit because you're broadcasting, so we're plugging you in and moving you around and everything else. And what games have you had so far? What leagues have you covered?
So I've covered the HJCAC Junior College Football Conference. I've had the pleasure of doing color for both of those games and have absolutely loved it. I love the rush of finding the coach after the game, calling and researching.
Do they run away from you?
In the beginning, tensions are high. It's hard to get the pregame more than the postgame. The postgame's easy when you get the winning coach because, of course, they want to talk. But, no, both are very fun. I've gotten great experience from both, and it's just been great. And then otherwise I've done camera operations for high school.
What's it been like? Let's talk about the broadcasting, because this was kind of new, getting thrown in front of a mic, because you had other opportunities. And I you know, look, I'm going to toot my own horn a little bit. I talked to you, and I saw your resume, and I said, we got to get you on a mic. And I was kind of aggressive to a point where you, like, backed off. You didn't want to do it. You're thinking, man, this guy's creepy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know.
No,
you could say it. Okay, not creepy. but a little aggressive, persistent.
Yes.
Because I saw that in you, and I know it's work. It's extra work. But I saw something in you positive that would not only benefit you, but obviously benefit us and raise the stature what you're doing or what we're doing. And Dylan, so likewise with you as well. I mean, you're managing a crew out there. So, you know, is that a challenge was it initially hard? I'll put this out there to both of you. Was it difficult? How has it gone?
I think for me, it's the reason I was hesitant to add it onto the schedule is just because the type of person I am, I like to, you know, it's quality over quantity in my opinion, and I like to give my full effort, but, you know, we were able to work it out where I am able to manage everything. And, you know, it goes back to the principle of time management we were talking about earlier, that volleyball has instilled in me and other aspects of life, and I think it's definitely paid off. I've already, within the first 3 weeks, added to my reel because of this, so I'm very grateful for this opportunity.
Good. And what about you, Dylan?
Yeah, this past few weeks have been really fast, honestly. Building the team was honestly kind of difficult to get going. But now our team is flowing real well, being able to work with the anchors every week. Cade Cameron and James Adams, two really all-star commentators. James will get real spicy on the mic and start talking real loud and getting real into the game, which makes my job easier when it comes to trying to show what he's talking about. And that aspect has been really nice. Getting down with my PA, my production assistant. We're building a lot of chemistry there, and when it's time to go to commercials, when it's time to switch to a break, we've got that dynamic down with the anchors now, which is really nice. And then our camera people have been fluctuating, but we're actually doing really well being able to call them, not having any experience for some of our camera people, and then building their confidence. And I think we're having really good shows.
Well, and you're talking about a crew of seven, so it's not going to be the consistency week in and week out. There's always going to be someone new that's jumping in, someone jumping out, but I mean, that's part of this business, and you wear multiple hats and you kind of roll with the punches. And likewise, Noelle, when you know you're working the chemistry with your co-anchor when you're doing a broadcast, it's not always going to be the same person. You wish it was, but it's knowing how to pivot and develop that. What I want to, and I'm sorry, we've got less than 2 minutes in this segment, but let's talk a little ASU volleyball. It's near and dear to your heart, Noelle. What's going on in Tempe?
Yeah, so in Tempe, we have a great team this year, I must say. Almost everybody's a returner. I think we took on two freshmen this year with this year's team, and only two seniors have been in the program for all 4 years. So a lot of experience from the last season, and so far, they have only had one classic at home. The Webb Burbage Classic was their home opener at the end of August. In the whole month of September, they have been traveling. They've participated in the Georgia Tech Invitational, Baylor Invitational, Red Raider Classic, and just recently opened Pac-12 play this past Wednesday against none other than U of A. And that was their season conference opener, and they ended up winning the match in four sets. So
nice.
Fell in the first one, 25-23 to Tucson, but then quickly were able to turn it around. And I think they have a lot of experience going to five sets because they play a best 3 out of 5. And last year, I think they fell short by 8 games. They fell short in sets to 5. So they've definitely turned that around this year. And just some notable players is the leadership. Even though there are the only two seniors, Annika Larson-Numer and Iman Asanovich, they are the two seniors this year that have been in the program for these past 4 years. They've been through COVID. They've been through it all. And they really do a great job in their court presence and in the program as a whole for that leadership aspect. Isanovich is the leading outside, and Annika is the libero on defense. So they're really great for the team altogether.
Nice. And we are looking forward to more coverage of ASU volleyball as the weeks go on, and you're going to be there to provide it for us. Good stuff. Guys, when we come back from the break, we have a lot of content. We're doing a feature on NYS football. As you know, we are the official broadcast team for NYS youth football. We've got a game tonight, and we've got one of the coaches on with us. We've got some other reports. Coach Lucas Ramirez with the Saguaro basketball report will be joining us in the next segment, as well as others. Stick around, folks. Welcome to the Varsity Sports Show. Noelle, Dylan, and I are in studio today. It's going to be a great one. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back after the break.
Bringing you the latest sports topics weekly right here on KDUS AM 1060 with me, the Doug Gottlieb Show, 1 to 3 p.m.
Hi, this is Kelsey Dickerson, and I start my Saturday mornings the right way, listening to Vince and the Varsity Crew on the Varsity Sports Show from 9 to 10 a.m. on AM 1060, KDUS, Arizona's home for youth, high school, college, and you.
Hey guys, Vince here to talk to you about a good friend of mine named Bob Jenkins. Bob is a Marine Corps veteran. Bob and his younger brother DJ own Vets Built Contracting. You've seen their trucks around Metro Phoenix, I'm sure. For 5 years, they've been hiring and putting veterans to work. Vets Built is licensed, bonded, and insured, both residential and commercial, specializing in renovations, remodeling, new build, casitas, safe rooms, or small commercial TI work. If you're a skilled veteran looking for work, a homeowner in need of work, or a commercial business needing TI work, please call Bob or DJ at Vets Built at 480-584-3675.
Founder-level sponsors, the Kristen Graziano Group with HomeSmart Elite, are proud to be Saguaro alumni, community advocates, and your hometown realtors. The Kristen Graziano Group is ranked in the top 1.5% of real estate teams nationally and your top-selling team right here in Sabercat territory. The Kristen Graziano Group can currently be seen on the Emmy-nominated TV show Selling the Valley of the Sun. When you're ready to buy, sell, or want to know the value of your home, reach out to the group that knows the neighborhood, the Kristen Graziano Group.
My name is Sherry Miller, and I am calling because I watch your broadcast of Canyon View every Friday night because my grandson in Arizona plays for them. And I just want to tell you how impressed I am by the young man who does the, I guess you would call it, play-by-play. He's very excited. He's very cute.
Get the morning work blues.
Will you stop honking, Mac? We ain't going nowhere.
Don't worry. Tune in to Bob Kemp in the Sports Zone. Weekdays 9 to 11 a.m. for all the best national and local sports content.
It's the NYS on the Varsity Sports Show. AM 1060, KDUS, Arizona.
All right, everyone, welcome to the Varsity Sports Show. I am Shai Gara, and today I'm pleased to be joined by head coach Matt Conroy of the Queen Creek Knights in the NYS Football League here in Arizona. And this Saturday night on the Varsity Sports Show at 6 p.m., they'll be taking on the East Valley Bulls, looking to get the win. Coach, thank you so much for joining us here on the Varsity Sports Show.
Thank you for having me.
Of course. And Coach, so coming into this matchup, or coming into any given matchup in a week, what's kind of the mindset heading into that week? Do you kind of focus more on what you might have done right or wrong in the week before? Or do you focus on that current matchup or some combination of both possibly? What's kind of the mindset coming into a new week?
Coming into a new week, we typically just touch base on this is the stuff we noticed that we need to work on as a team and stuff that we did great on and continue to build upon that. Obviously, moving forward within that week, when you're just worried about that particular matchup itself and what your team's strengths are and what you want to utilize during that week.
Right. And being the coach of such young, impressionable players at this young age, where I'm sure a lot of these players, they aspire to play in high school and even beyond possibly. So what's kind of an important lesson you feel like at this extremely young age, it's important for kids to learn about the game of football, whether it be on or off the field? What's kind of an important lesson you hope that kids at this age learn going forward?
You know, I had a great opportunity of playing youth sports and then playing Division I football in college, so I had great mentors along the way. And that's what we build upon our coaching staff. We had coaches that played in the NFL, Division I level, FCS level, high school. I've coached at the high school level. So, you know, it's just really good to give back to the kids and to show them, hey, this is how you become a great mentor, great leader in our society today. So that's really the driven home message that we deliver to them, because football is just a short amount of life. So we're trying to build them life skills that they can use for the future, because football is just a small percentage of someone's life. So if we can teach them how to be great men, how to be respectful, and that stuff, and that's really touching the main message for us.
Right. I mean, it's just, at this age, you can learn so much about football that goes beyond just the field. Like you said, it's just you learn life lessons in sports, especially youth sports. So I agree. It's just so important to learn lessons like that. So, Coach, thank you so much for joining the Varsity Sports Show. We really appreciate your time, taking the time to be with us. And good luck this Saturday with your game. And thank you so much again for taking the time.
Thank you very much for having me. Appreciate it.
You You're listening to the home of Saguaro Sabercat Basketball, the Varsity Sports Show, AM 1060, KDUS, Arizona. And now, here's Coach Lucas Ramirez.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Jacob Carlisle, and I work for the Varsity Sports Radio Show. And today, my guest is head varsity basketball coach of the Saguaro Sabercats, Lucas Ramirez. How are you doing today, Lucas?
Hey, how are you doing? Well.
Good. Just a few questions for you. What were some of the goals of yours in the offseason?
Yeah, you know, every offseason we have probably a couple different goals. You know, our season ended in February, so we gave him about a month off. And then once we got back from spring break, we hit the ground running again in the weight room, on the court. So our goals is, you know, are for our players to individually develop with their basketball skills and also their strength and conditioning. And then we really use the summertime to come together as a team, you know, because June's a lot of events, tournaments, leagues, different things like that. And it's kind of the same focus come fall, what we're in right now. We are doing a lot of individual skill work, focusing on our own individual strength and conditioning. But as we get closer and closer, the more time we're in the gym prior to tryouts and our season starting, it's more team focused to get us prepared for, you know, our scrimmages and then ultimately moving into the season.
How important are the small things and how important is the classroom when it comes to basketball or playing for Saguaro?
Oh, yeah, huge. Small things are big things, you know, and I picked that up in the offseason listening to another coach speak because all our lives we kind of hear, you know, hey, you got to do the little things. Well, if you got to do the little things, then they're big things, right? If it's that important. So I've really tried to translate my lingo and translate the messaging we send to our kids. Everything matters. How you do anything is how you do everything. And, you know, that's in the classroom, that's in the weight room, that's how are you behaving socially and out in the community. You know, it all translates and it all goes together.
How important is it to play both sides of the ball?
Oh, if you want to stay on the floor, you got to do both. Or if you want to extend your chances of staying on the floor. No, I mean, it's important. You know, everyone, I hate the phrase, you see it at the college level or the professional level or even top prospects. People say, oh, he's a two-way player. Well, last time I checked, it's not like an offense and defense in football. You should be a two-way player in basketball. But no, I mean, all kidding aside, I mean, it's huge, right? But also too, like, I'm not going to downplay the fact too, that there are guys that, you know, they are a better defender than they are maybe a shooter, or they're a better shooter than they are a defender, but they're still capable. So having the ability, I think, to adapt and adjust to whether it's different types of defenses or being able to play different styles of basketball offensively, even again, it all fits together and translates. But yeah, no, I mean, if you want to stay on the floor, then definitely defend and rebound. Our coaches always say, well, if you want to be in the game, then rebound and play defense, right?
And one last question, what can we expect from you guys this season on the court?
I'm excited. I'm really excited about our group. Hopefully every coach says that in September. Ask me again in January and February. But no, we always tell our guys we want to play our best basketball. The second half of the year, as we get ready for the postseason, we have, you know, 5-6 seniors, you know, 7 or 8 returners, and then a couple of guys who are currently playing football that will be able to help us. We have really talented lower levels. So I like what we're bringing onto the court. I really like our schedule because it is tough. Like, I don't want to run away from any schedule, anybody. Enter St. Mary's to our region. They're an open division type team. Mesquite's returning 4A state champs. They're going to be really talented again. Enter Arcadia, which I love. We can bring in a district school that will make, hopefully build and create a fun rivalry for us. You know, and I could keep going down the line in our region. Seton Catholic has a brand new head coach. They were well coached before. So that's going to be a fun matchup. It always is. Marcos Deniza has one of the longest tenured head coaches with David Stark, who's become a great colleague and friend. And, you know, he's a legend in my eyes. Every time you play them, you got to be ready. So tough region, which is great. The open division aspect will make this year fun in Arizona. Throw the shot clock in, it'll make it for a fun year too. So there's a lot of different elements that make this season really one to look forward to. And then, you know, talking about everything, even our non-region schedule is great too. You know, we have a chance to play Dysart, who knocked us out of the postseason last year. So, you know, we're hungry to see them again. And then, I mean, from top to bottom, our first game, we travel to Flagstaff. Always fun to kind of make that type of trip and have that challenge right out the gate. Play a bunch of great teams out in the East Valley. So, you know, a lot of great competition, you know, for us as a program and you know, really all across Arizona.
Again, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Jacob Carlisle, and I work for the Varsity Sports Radio Show, and my guest is head varsity basketball coach of the Saguaro Sabercats, Lucas Ramirez. Thank you for the interview, and good luck this season.
It's time to check in on the Olympic sports now. After finishing 6-6 in non-conference play, ASU volleyball started the Pac-12 season with a 3-1 upset over the Arizona Wildcats on Wednesday. It's the Sun Devils' first win in Tucson since 2019, and the Wildcats' first loss at home this season. Senior outside hitter Iman Asanovich earned her 6th double-double of the season, leading the Sun Devils with 18 kills and 12 digs. But she wasn't the only one contributing on the kills. Junior outside hitter Marta Levinska had 17, and sophomore Jelly Sear had a career high of 15. The Wildcats went ahead 8-2 early in the first set and won 25-23. But ASU maintained control the rest of the match as they won 25-20, 26-24, and 25-20. Pac-12 play continues on the road for the Sun Devils tomorrow at 12 p.m. in Colorado on Pac-12 Insider. From there, they'll go to the Pacific Northwest next weekend for matches against Oregon and Oregon State before returning home to face the UCLA Bruins on October 7th. You've been listening to the Sun Devil Volleyball Report on the Varsity Sports Show, brought to you by Anthony Remedios. Now, back to your hosts, Vince DeLicio, Dylan denDekker, and Noelle Blumel.
This is Paul Schultz for the Varsity Sports Show, and I'm joined by Hal Reeser, the head coach of the Sonoran Sidewinders. Coach, you had a big win to start the season and have had a couple tough losses since then. And you told me earlier in the season that you've basically built the team from the ground up. So can you give me a sense where you feel your team is at this point in the season?
So at this level of football, your team is evolving, your team is changing. I mean, you know, because we're really trying to build a culture here, a winning culture here. We're really trying to build something that is that's really never been here before. And we're trying to hold our guys to a standard, you know, day in, day out. To us, character matters. Showing up every day the right way. We're going to have struggles like any football team, but we're just trying to build a culture that our guys want to be a part of. And there's going to be struggles along the way. And, you know, we're no different in year one than most teams around the country from every level of football.
And you guys are taking on the Pumas this weekend, the Papago Pumas. What's your scouting report on them? What are you expecting from them this week?
They're a pressure defense. They're going to bring it, and we got to protect. I think that's where the game's going to be won, is our ability to protect against a 3-3 stack. And I watched that ACU game. They really couldn't protect. And I think that's where the difference is going to be. What can we do? We got to get the ball out quicker. We got to hold our blocks, maintain our blocks, get to our blocks, and guys have to get on the right block. I love their defense. I love the pressure defense. I think they've got athletes at every position. I think they play hard. I think they offensively, they got a quarterback that keeps plays alive and makes some crazy throws. He made some crazy throws last week, and I'm just like, yeah, if we don't get there with our front, we're going to have some problems.
All right. Thank you very much for your time. Good luck this week, and we'll see you at the game.
Your morning drive just got a little better. The Dan Patrick Show is live weekday morning starting at 6 exclusively on KDUS AM 1060.
Training Better Athletes was founded by renowned football coach Ron Sowers with the philosophy of training well-rounded young people in mind and body. TBA is the go-to for middle schoolers through the pros. Coach Sowers has worked with all sports but specializes in football offensive and defensive line skills training. Whether it's one-on-one or group training, reach out to Coach Sowers at trainingbetterathletes.com or call him at 602-435-9064. You can't cheat the grind.
Welcome to the Jaguar Nation. The Varsity Sports Show is proud to partner up with Canyon View High School in the West Valley to be the voice of Jaguar athletics. Tune in on Saturdays to hear the Jaguar Nation, featuring coaches, students, and staff between 9 and 10 a.m. on AM 1060 KDUS, and subscribe to the Varsity Sports Show YouTube channel to get free, exclusive coverage of Canyon View sporting events. Welcome to the Jaguar Nation.
Jack it up.
Hey, local businesses, join the Varsity Sports Show and promote your business on our weekly radio show and game live streams. We have several options to promote your business affordably and reach our incredible audience. Call, text, or email us anytime if you'd like more information on joining our team. The Varsity Sports Show will work hard to promote your business through our audio and video platforms while also promoting all of our young people. 480-779-9437 or email us at varsitysportsshow.com.
Hi there, this is Willow Canyon men's basketball coach Joseph Coletti. You are listening to the home of Wildcat Basketball, the Varsity Sports Show, 1060 AM, KDUS, Arizona.
Hey, football fans, this is the Rooster. Join me all day Sunday as No Huddle will be broadcasting live and giving away prizes from Casey Jones, located in Phoenix on 28th Street and Bell Road.
It's the JUCO Report on AM 1060 KDUS Arizona, the Varsity Sports Show. News and notes from the HOHOCOM Junior College Athletic Conference.
Welcome back to Varsity Sports Show, AM 1060. This is Noelle Blumel. We are joined by Papago Pumas assistant head coach William Strother. Coach, how are you doing this morning?
Coach Strother, I think he's in process. I think we just got him on the phone. Coach Strother, good morning, sir.
Hey, good morning. Good morning.
How's it going?
Pretty good.
Coach, we're great. We're in studio with I want to introduce you to Dylan and Noelle, and they've got a couple questions for you. Now, first of all, I do have to say that I did receive your message that there's the game got postponed for this evening, but we do want to talk to you about your team. Noelle, go ahead. Take it away.
Yeah, Coach, so just kind of a general question overview. How do you feel the team has met or exceeded expectations up until this point in the season?
Well, you know, we still got a lot of growth that we want to do. You know, we set ourselves out on three categories: relationship, championship, scholarship. And, you know, relationship was the number one key aspect to it, where, you know, we wanted to bond together as a team. And then, you know, championship, you know, that was the goal that we're chasing right now. And lastly is, you know, after we get that championship, we want to get scholarships for these kids and place them. So we're still just moving forward, trying to accomplish the second phase of our goals.
Absolutely. And kind of going off that aspect of relationships, how do you as a coach approach that with, you know, keeping in mind the HJCAC conference, everybody in here, there's a lot of transfers, you know, in that short amount of time, how are you able to form those relationships in typically such a short amount of time with the team?
You know, we try to first bond with the players and the family, the mother, the father, whomever that primary caregiver is. You know, when we do our recruiting, you know, it's critical and it's vital to us that, you know, before we accept the commitment, you know, that we speak with the family. We have it to where we want everybody 100% in. It can't be 99% on 1% hanging left out there, because if it's 1% hanging out there, there's still the possibility of doubt. So we try to take away the doubt, and we go and speak with, you know, the entire family to make sure they all feel comfortable with our program, what we're trying to teach, the direction we want to take their player as an academically and on the field. And if, you know, all in all isn't 100%, we feel like we've got a great relationship bond built right there.
Coach, Dylan denDekker here. Thank you again for joining us this morning. How do you build chemistry between those athletes that you have? Because chemistry is kind of what's going to lead you guys to success.
Yeah, so what we do is we try to get kids to know each other. So we actually give them tests. And we say, hey, go bond with your player. Figure out, you know, ask him questions. Ask him what his goals are. Ask him about his family. Ask him where he's come from. And then we tell each other, you know, follow your brother on Twitter. If he does something excellent, you know, tweet it out, you know, because you never know how far just a little bit of tweet or finding out, asking a small little question will help bond. Also in practice, you know, we like to create, you know, competition to where, you know, offense and defense guys come together. We make sure that we have some kind of fun activity within the practice. So we use a lot of different ways to just create a good chemistry. It's been working so far.
Absolutely. And, Coach, kind of backtracking here to the season opener against the Maricopa Mustangs, I had the pleasure of calling color for that game. It was a rather, you know, high-tension game, which ended in a victory, season-opening victory for you guys. But one specific instance, I remember at the end of the second quarter, head coach Payne, this crucial huddle, I kept hearing the word discipline come from him, like discipline over and over. And I remember asking him about the intangibles, I guess, that are important to him in instilling in a team. So I now want to pose that question to you. When crafting a team and trying to lead them to success, what are those off the field intangible aspects that you believe are important and essential for a team's success?
Yeah, I mean, as you said, Coach Payne preached discipline. I mean, we preach that consistently on a regular basis. Discipline. The most disciplined team doesn't have to be the most talented team, but discipline will outweigh talent. And if we are a disciplined team, that means we execute effectively. You know, we need to be able to execute effectively to make sure that we are trying to accomplish our goals. And if we are disciplined, we're going to win the game. Now, if we get outside of discipline and we start playing down to all the talk on the field and other guys wanting to bring attention to unnecessary plays, we get out of discipline, we get out of our character, and then it becomes a game where now we got all these different penalties. We also hold our kids accountable for the penalties. So there's additional, you know, punishments during the practice week that, you know, we will put on our kids to say, hey, this is not a punishment for the one individual that went outside the lines and got the flag. This is a punishment for the entire team, because if he can't control and stay disciplined, that means we all can't. So we also make sure that players can look at it as, hey, you guys don't want to be disciplined in practice. Make sure that you all are now holding each other accountable yourselves. As coaches, we're the guides. And we guide you like a remote control. But you guys are the people that put it in effect. And if this happens on the football field, then it means all of you will have to be disciplined for one person's action.
Well, Coach, thank you so much for coming on. On behalf of the Varsity Sports Show, thanks again for joining us. Good luck next week. Hopefully we get another game from you guys soon, and we look forward to talking to you soon.
Appreciate it. Thank God for having me. Have a great day.
You too.
Hello, everybody. I'm Jay Wilder. Huge game today. Wildcats, Tigers. The Tigers pull away. I am alongside Carter Dickey and Cooper Zellner. I just want to ask you guys first. Crazy, crazy moments at the end of the game, right? There was the missed field goal, and there's also the fumble. So what is going through your guys' mind in those moments? I'll go with you first.
It was crazy. That's all I got to say. It's really crazy, and it was an exciting moment. We haven't had this in a while, and it's nice to finally come out on top against Mesquite.
Yeah, I guess once we saw the missed field goal, I was like, all right, we got this in the bag. And then a couple things happened. They got the ball back. And then I had trust in our defense, I had trust in our offense that we would get it done. And once it came down, our coach always says it comes down to special teams, and we got the special teams dub. So,
yeah, Carter, you did it on both ends of the field. You got a touchdown offensively and defensively. Was there something about your routine that contributed to that success on both ends of the field?
I got to give it to my teammates. That really helped me out. Parker Bryce on that sack was an incredible play, and he gave me the opportunity to score on defense, which, and my line did a great job of blocking.
And lastly, Cooper, you started really hot on the ground. I think you're running established, like, momentum for your team early. So what can you say about the importance of running the ball and establishing that foundation?
Well, once you establish the run, you open up everything from the pass game. I mean, we didn't get as deep into the pass game as we wanted, but in the end, we got a touchdown that came from a pass. So it opens up all that opportunity, all the other half of the playbook. So establishing the run is a big part. And then it's kind of who wants it more. I mean, it lets them know that we're coming every game, or like all day for the rest of the night on the ground. So we're coming. We're hungry. So
he is Cooper Zellner. He is Carter Dickey. I'm Jay Wilder. Tigers win.
Hey, football fans, this is Ralph from Carefree. The Varsity Sports Show presents the Thursday night High School Football Team of the Week.
The Thursday night High School Football Team of the Week.
All right, we are now joined by head coach of Central High School, Coach Chandler Hovick. Coach, big win here tonight, a scrappy win for you tonight. What was the message going into the locker room to kind of keep them disciplined and ready to keep playing and focused for the second half of the game?
All week we told the boys, in a rival game like this, it's raining. We don't care if we win 2-0. We don't care if it's 1,000-0. We just got to find a way. And those guys buckled down the second half, and they played tough as nails.
Yeah, okay, so coming into the second, almost that second half of the season, that midway point, you have Alhambra on the schedule for next week. Well, how does that mentality change from how it was at the beginning of the season to where it is now?
I mean, we're right where we need to be. You know, we've got off to a hot start going 3-1. Now we got to take care of business with Alhambra. You know, it's a sister school, we call them, in the Phoenix Union, so it's good to battle against those guys. Those guys will be tough, and then we're on to region play, so we got to finish out non-region tough.
All right, congrats on the win, Coach.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
It's the NYS on the Varsity Sports Show, AM 1060, KDUS, Arizona.
Welcome back to Varsity Sports Show. My name is Ana De La Cruz, and today I am with Randy Blunt, who is our East Valley Bulls 12U coach. Coach Randy, how long have you been coaching youth football?
Actually, I've been coaching about 2 years, so... last year I started coaching in the fall. I coached in the fall and in the spring, so this will be my third season.
What got you like into coaching?
It was kind of a little bit out of necessity, right? I played football growing up, loved the sport. My son decided he wanted to play. I showed up at practice, and they didn't have enough coaches last year, and so I was like, well, I'll give it a shot, and I ended up having a lot of fun.
And ended up working out. What's it like being able to coach like the next generation of kids?
Yeah, so for me, it's a lot about, you know, I look back at football for me, and I didn't go on to play Division I football or, you know, anything after high school, but I learned a lot of life lessons there, you know, how to push myself, how to realize that I could do more than I thought I could. And so for me, it's really exciting just to help these young men develop into good human beings. And so obviously we want to be competitive, we want to win, but you know, I think some of the things that we get to teach them that are most valuable is how to, you know, overcome life's challenges that they'll face, and how to dig deep and get through tough times.
Yeah, at the end of the day, that's what matters most. Sure. So you are 1-1 this year. What have your games been like? What has like the season looked like for you?
Yeah, so we actually have two 12U teams. So we came into this season, me and the other coach who coached last year, and we had, I think, 48 kids that showed up to play 12U football. And so we decided to split into two teams. And our team has more of the less experienced kids.
Oh.
So we're kind of finding our stride. A lot of talent, but new to tackle football. And so that first game, our offense just had a really hard time getting going. A lot of people who didn't know the plays well enough. And so we spent that week really working on offense. And last week we saw a little bit more spark there. So defense has played pretty well both games. And now it's just getting people to know their assignments and to even carry them out consistently.
So is that what, like, you've been stressing out during practice, like just getting that offense started up and like sparked up? Because you said your defense is fine. So like, is that what you've been working on?
Yeah, we've been focusing on the offense and getting people to know their assignments. Also, you know, running game is at 12, you're still probably a little bit more dependent on the run game.
Yeah.
You're developing that passing game. And so really working on offensive linemen, knowing their assignments, and understanding the fundamentals of blocking, sustaining blocks. So been working on kind of the skill positions, knowing where to go and where to be, but also really driving home the fundamentals of good blocking.
All right. And then what are you expecting to see from your team this Saturday?
Yeah, so we've talked about this. I think the opponent we're playing is a pretty good football team. And so, you know, definitely there's respect going into this game for their talents. And so we want to put up a good defensive game, continue to, you know, really eliminate those big plays. And then we feel like if we can eliminate the big plays and we put together some consistent offensive drives, we've got a really good shot at this game. We're looking forward to trying out some new things today on our passing game, and then really establishing a run game so that hopefully we have some play action pass that we can throw into the game.
All right, Randy, thank you so much for joining me today. This is Ana De La Cruz with Varsity Sports Show.
Hey, Phoenix, Doug Gottlieb here. I'm bringing the best sports talk weekdays to you, 1 to 3 p.m., right here on KDUS AM 1060.
Hey guys, Vince here to talk about Angel Dentistry. It's where my wife and I have gone for over 10 years, and we trust them with our routine and extensive dental care because they care. Dr. Amber Angel is an Arizona native, born in the town of Miami, and has been practicing in the Valley over 20 years. For general to comprehensive dental services, call 602-788-2008. Located off of Cave Creek Road, just north of the 101 in North Phoenix, Angel Dentistry, proud supporters of our young people and proud partners of the Varsity Sports Show. The Varsity Sports Show is proud to partner with Sabercat Athletics. That's right, the Scottsdale Saguaro Sabercats are on the Varsity Sports Show. Join the Varsity team as we cover the Cats during the Sabercat Report on Saturday morning's Varsity Sports Show on AM 1060 KDUS Arizona, featuring players, coaches, and commentary. Look out for live stream coverage of Saguaro Sabercat sporting events by going to YouTube and searching for Varsity Sports Show, then click that subscribe button to stay up to date. The Saguaro Sabercats are here. Hey, local businesses, join the Varsity Sports Show and promote your business on our weekly radio show and game live streams. We have several options to promote your business affordably and reach our incredible audience. Call, text, or email us anytime if you'd like more information on joining our team. The Varsity Sports Show will work hard to promote your business through our audio and video platforms while also promoting all of our young people. 480-779-9437 or email us at varsitysportsshow.com. Chris Scott of REMAX is Central Oregon's best realtor for anyone thinking of a vacation home or relocation. He's our very own, born and raised Venetian, who moved his family to Central Oregon nearly 15 years ago. Contact Chris if you're thinking of exploring beautiful Central Oregon. It truly is living at its best. 541-999-5614. Proud partner of the Varsity Sports Show's It's Dylan.
The Dan Patrick Show, weekday mornings from 6 to 9 a.m.
This is just something I like to call breakfast.
With big name guests, timely sports information, and more on KDUS AM 1060.
Welcome to Dylan. He's out and about looking for fun. He's Dylan. Brought to you by Chris Scott of RE/MAX Key Properties in Bend, Oregon, where it's living at its best. 541-999-5614. And now, it's Dylan.
Welcome back to Varsity Sports Show, AM 1060. This is It's Dylan with our guest, Dylan Weinmiller. Dylan, how are you doing this morning?
I'm doing wonderful this morning. Thank you. How are you guys?
Doing great. I'm alongside another Dylan and Vince Delisio here in the studio this morning.
Yeah, yeah. I get confused every time I'm listening. I hear the name Dylan. I'm like looking. Someone's calling my name.
No, that's me, Dylan denDekker with the Varsity Sports Show. Talk to a little bit about the games this week. Would you see this out this last Friday?
And I have to jump in here. So I'm trying to help you out, Dylan, because I know Chris Scott, who, you know, is the sponsor of this segment, has asked me to be a little kinder to you. So I'm trying to hold back and literally sitting on my hands with duct tape on my mouth.
But I couldn't help but interrupt the other Dylan.
I could not help that and interrupt the other Dylan. I'm sorry, Dylan.
Hopefully this Dylan's as tough as I am and will smack you in the face next time you interrupt me.
There we go. All right, now you guys go ahead.
The games I saw this week, I went to the Central and North game. I'm a Phoenix Union grad, a North High grad. So, you know, I kind of was a little biased for that one, but you know, what I saw was hard fought game. A lot of penalties, too many penalties still, you know, for both teams. A lot of stuff that kind of happened, a little bit of a drama that you never want to see, you know, just from a coaching point of view and you know, I guess as a fan too, but just got to see some old friends, got to actually see an old girlfriend, my old boss, an AD that I worked with and coached with for many years, got to see his wife. So it was pretty fun just, you know, being back at the home stadium and seeing the facilities again and just being on the sidelines, a lot of fun. Got to meet a few of the other Varsity Sports Show guys. Good group of guys. You know, yeah, it was just fun. I wish it would have kind of gone the other way, but I'm happy for the Central program. They've been working hard for a few years, getting this thing kind of straightened out. And it looks like he's got a good thing going. And I'm really proud of him. He's a younger guy. We competed against each other when I was coaching and he was playing. And then we've just kept up a really nice conversation and relationship over the years. So good stuff. And then, you know, just this weekend's all college football today. And then tomorrow, the Rams. The RWO is going to be in full effect. And we are going to take it to the Cardinals in the stadium down there.
And going off of those college games, who are you most looking forward to watching today specifically?
Yeah, I'll follow the teams where I kind of have some heart and, you know, whatnot. Like, I'm an Oklahoma fan, been an Oklahoma fan since probably, you know, freshman year, eighth grade, freshman year of high school, somewhere in there. Maybe even longer than that, but I've got some friends that coach for Penn State and Oregon, so they're always kind of on my mind wherever they're coaching. I kind of follow them and see what they're up to, cheer for them, root for them, and that.
All right, looking at this schedule, works a lot of these high school games are going into their real season here. What is one matchup you're looking for either this week or in the following weeks that is going to be a game to watch?
Well, you know, for me, I like to give the attention to the smaller teams, right? The Phoenix Union High School District. I did go do a game down in Bisbee, the Bisbee-Douglas game. I'm actually looking forward to some small-town rivalry games. I want to make it up to the Prescott-Bradshaw Mountain game pretty soon. The Globe-Miami game is another one. You know, no offense to anybody, but just the bigger schools get enough coverage, you know, and I know what they're about, and I know how good they are, so I don't need to go and watch that. You know, when it gets playoff time, then, of course, you know, I'll start paying more attention to who's doing what and all that. But, you know, I like to really kind of go and just see some of the out-of-the-box teams and see how they're doing and just follow them a little bit.
Absolutely. Well, Dylan Weinmiller, thank you so much for joining us on this segment.
This was so much nicer talking to you guys than that other loudmouth.
Oh, whatever. Get over it.
Hey, Vince, did you know that we placed dead last yesterday in the tournament?
In the golf tournament. We're going to have a report on that a little later in the show, so thank you for that. And
dead last.
Yeah, dead last, of
dead
course. Makes
last.
Sense.
It was embarrassing.
All right. Dylan Weinmiller with It's Dylan. Thank you to Chris Scott from Bend, Oregon. Chris Scott Realty for sponsoring this this segment.
Yeah,
anyway,
it was the best. Right. It was best, yeah. Not talking to you. Thank you so much, guys. Have a great day.
You too.
Hey, Varsity Sports Show. This is Aaron Herpy, and I'm giving you a special recap of a cross-country meet. The Aaron Botma Invitational was this past Tuesday at Mountain Vista Park. It featured different teams from Division 3 and 4. Glenn Thomas from Northwest won the boys 5,000 meter with a time of 17 minutes and 15.05 seconds. Valley Christian won the boys varsity division with 41 points and a team average of 18 minutes and 22 seconds. Tegan Fears placed first for the girls with a time of 20 minutes and 42.60 seconds. Northwest Christian placed first in the girls varsity team with a score of 36 points and with an average time of 22 minutes and 42 seconds. I was able to talk with the Horizon Honors team and their head coach, David Chetlin. He said this is the best team he has had in 6 years, and they hope to take a full boys team to states this year. They've previously taken individuals, but no team. They finished sixth this meet, which is a good look when they were battling the heat and runners were sore. This is Aaron Herpy with Varsity Sports Show, and make sure you stay tuned as I follow Horizon Honors Cross Country's journey to states this season.
Welcome back to Varsity Sports Show, 10 a.m. 1060. This is Noelle Blumel alongside Dylan and Vince in the studio this morning, and we're going to talk a little bit about the First Tee golf program, specifically here in Phoenix. So recently, four Phoenix kids were selected to participate in the PGA Tour Champions Pure Insurance Championship at Pebble Beach up in California. So they're traveling up there. It was Isabel Junio, Caden Clark, Lena Durrett, and Jack Lehman, all 16 to 17 years old. They were selected to participate based on their personal growth and development through the First Tees programs, as well as their playing ability, of course. These are stellar athletes who have clearly made their way up until this point in their high school career, and some of them even hope to take it to the professional career. But basically, for those of you out there who aren't familiar with First Tee, it is a nonprofit organization that teaches the youth who are interested in golf and athletic children life skills through intentional and strategic golf lessons. And within the program, instructors emphasize the 9 core values. I had the pleasure of speaking to all 4 of the athletes selected to participate in this tournament, and all 4 of them brought it back to the 9 core values that this program has instilled in them for the past 10 years, which is how long they've been involved. And those 9 values are perseverance, sportsmanship, honesty, integrity, responsibility, respect, confidence, courtesy, and judgment. And so it's really, these kids are very well-rounded. They're very talented in the golf aspect, and they're very well-spoken and just have all the intangibles all around to further their career in this field. And so specifically, I had the pleasure of speaking with Jack Lehman, who wants to hopefully further his golf career to the collegiate level. He's in contact with some colleges currently, but specifically when I was asking, I was curious to know how the golf lessons instill the intangibles within these kids. And he said things such as moving your ball out of the way for other people and just kind of having that courtesy of you know, being mindful of the people around you and how it translates into the real world. And they said without First Tee, all 4 kids said without First Tee, they wouldn't be the people they are. They have 2-hour info sessions twice a week in addition to their practices to really hone in on those intangibles and make them well-rounded and well-spoken. And they have workshops that help them in on their well-roundedness, and they're all just so excited to be participating. I think the first night of the tournament was last night, so it'll be really fun to see how they do the rest of this weekend, tonight at 7 p.m. and tomorrow at 7 p.m. as well. So hopefully rooting for the Phoenix kids out here, but hopefully they come out on top.
Wow, Pebble Beach is actually a really nice golf course on the coast of California. I'm not truly a golfer here, but thank you for that story. Where can we check out some more about that story?
I would definitely check sports360az.com. There are multiple articles of coverage on this tournament there.
Can't shy lightly. I see that you wrote a story yourself.
Yes.
Alrighty. Well, thank you guys so much. Thank you, Noelle, for that story. We'll be right back after this short break.
Thank you for listening to the Varsity Sports Show, where our mission is to empower education and enable dreams, creating an unmatched platform to showcase talent both in front of and behind the microphone in radio, television, podcast, and live streaming. The Varsity Sports Show, still your home for youth, high school, college, and you in Arizona and beyond.
AM 1060 KDUS Tempe Phoenix and KSLX HD2 Scottsdale Phoenix.
Hi, this is John Crane, Vice Mayor Carefree, and you're listening to the Varsity Sports Show on AM 1060.
Hey, local businesses, join the Varsity Sports Show and promote your business on our weekly radio show and game live streams. We have several options to promote your business affordably and reach our incredible audience. Call, text, or email us anytime if you'd like more information on joining our team. The Varsity Sports Show will work hard to promote your business through our audio and video platforms while also promoting all of our young people. 480-779-9437 or email us at varsitysportsshow.com. In 2019, the JV Sports Show podcast began with the idea of spotlighting young people in our community. In time, that podcast evolved into radio, television, and live stream, and through that evolution, new ideas have enhanced delivery, giving a stage to students both in front of and behind the microphone in Arizona and beyond. Thank you for supporting the Varsity Sports Show, now the Varsity Media Foundation, a 501c3 educational organization.
KDUS AM 1060 Tempe Phoenix and KSLX HD2 Scottsdale Phoenix is brought to you by AC by J Heating, Cooling, Plumbing, and Drains.
This program is paid for by the Varsity Media Foundation, a 501c3 nonprofit educational organization, and its partners.
You're listening to the Varsity Sports Show, home of Arizona's youth, high school, college sports, and you, empowering education and enabling dreams right here on KDUS AM 1060 in Arizona. And now, welcome to the Varsity Sports Show.
It's time for Nate's Take. Musings, observations, and contemplation from ASU Sun Devil Football Hall of Famer Nathan LaDuke on the Varsity Sports Show. And now, here's Nate.
Thank you for that, Jay Wilder Adams. Welcome back to the Varsity Sports Show for hour number two, AM 1060 KDUS Arizona. Vince Delisio joined in studio by a couple of talented broadcasters in Noelle Blumel and Dylan denDekker. And we have a brand new segment here from an old friend of mine that is a pretty good dude. His resume is extensive, and he's out in the community doing a lot of philanthropic work. His name is Nathan LaDuke, and it's Nate's Take. Nate, how are you, sir?
I'm good, Vince. Good to be here. My voice is a little rough after last night, but
yeah.
I'll get through it.
Well, you know, your son is a star defensive back at ALA Queen Creek, and it's you know, he's doing a heck of a job. But I want to focus on you in this segment, and you're obviously out there helping to coach those guys up. So we got together and we talked about, first of all, Nathan, you know, you're like I said, your resume is I mean, for all the stuff that you, I know you're very humble and whatever, but you've done a lot of great things out there, and you also, you know, you've got some opinions on things, and you like to keep things on the up and up. You're one of the most positive guys I've ever met, and I sincerely mean that. It's funny because every time I send you a text, 30 seconds later, I get a phone call back from you. It's not like we have an endless, you know, conversation. You like to talk to people. You like reaching out. You like contact with people, and that's one thing I've known about you for years and years, is that it doesn't matter who it is, you like to engage people in a positive way. And so when we talked about this segment, you tell us exactly what you were looking for here.
Well, I mean, I think I have opinions, and I have a lot of experience, and I would say that I'm not an expert in anything in my life, but I feel like I probably have about as much just natural football knowledge as somebody could have, and certainly have observed things over the years and have formed a lot of opinions on those things, of which some of them are, there's probably some factual information that backs it up, and some of them are still just my opinions. But But, yeah, I like to, you know, I do like to keep things positive.
Yeah.
And that's been a little bit difficult for me over the last, you know, number of years with ASU. And, but I mean, I'm always going to support them and because I'm an alum from there and I want them to do well. And I think probably more of my lack of positivity is just due to frustration and desire for them to do better and to be better and so forth.
Well, and this segment is not always going to be about sports. Now, obviously today, you know, there's a lot of things going on out there and we've only got a couple of minutes to do it. I more or less wanted to kind of introduce this thing and you're going to be joining us, you know, every other week, every week, whenever you feel like it, we're going to have you on. I mean, that's how easygoing we are and accommodating to a guy like Nathan LeDuc, just like back in the old days when they would shut the weight room down when you were in there and you were, you know, doing your 800, 900 pound squats and nobody else was allowed in there, but no bitterness, but the thing is we're excited because it's not all doom and gloom because you support the program, you support athletics, but that also gives you validity in what you're saying when things are not so great all the time. And you happen to be really good friends with Sean Aguano, the interim head coach at ASU.
Yeah, you know, when Sean came to town, I think it was probably about 22 years ago, he and I got introduced. A buddy of mine was running a financial company, and Sean actually was working for him in the financial arena as like a, you know, money manager type person. And that's how he entered into the state of Arizona with that job. And he and I became really, really close, and we used to play golf quite a bit and run around and have fun. Sean was married at the time. I wasn't married. So Sean's wife probably doesn't like me very much, but, we had a lot of fun and developed a strong relationship. I love Sean Aguano. I think he is one of the most genuine, sincere people, you know, and his stint in the financial arena didn't last very long, probably because he just didn't have an unbelievable love for it like he did football. So
yeah.
It was pretty soon thereafter where he took an assistant job over at Chandler, and then from there just took over.
Now,
I told Sean when he got the job at ASU, I had been quietly lobbying for him to get on that staff for years before that, just because I felt like he could be an asset to the staff, especially from a recruiting standpoint, and especially from a local recruiting standpoint. Even though Sean, you know, became a dominant head coach over there at Chandler, and you know Chandler certainly beat up on lots of other high school football teams throughout the valley. I don't think that any of those opposing coaches, even the ones that got whooped up bad by Chandler, ever disliked Sean. I think that Sean had an incredible relationship with everybody.
Yes, he did.
And I think because of that, he would actually have the ability to reach back out into Arizona and reestablish relationships that. There just hasn't been an effort put into those things for, I would say almost the last 20 years. And that's just a matter of different staffs and different philosophies and where they have high school connections and where their strength in recruiting lies and maybe also how they evaluate particular talent in Arizona. And
so,
because of all those factors, I feel like for ASU, Arizona kids had just kind of fallen off the radar for at least the last 20 years.
I do need to ask you this. In the last 30 seconds of this segment, I'm going to ask you. So you obviously are authorized to speak on the topic because you're not just some fly-by-night armchair quarterback that is offering an opinion that has no backing and no background on it. Do you feel like right now Sean Aguano is the right person for the job at Arizona State University running the football program?
Well, you know, I do, and that probably comes with a very strong bias just because of I really have a great love for him just as a person. I also feel like and time will tell here as the season goes on, but I feel like there's a possibility that everything could align for him and that he could make a good enough showing to gather the troops back and compete in a way, whether he wins a bunch of games or not, that he gets ASU playing for him in a way that there would be some consideration. Also factored into that is there's going to probably be a hefty penalty coming down from the NCAA with all these investigations going on. And so the prospects of bringing in some, you know, unbelievable coach from the outside are not going to be necessarily great because of those limiting factors. So I'm sitting here speaking my hope. My hope is that what I just said will happen and that Sean will actually be given a legitimate chance to run this program. And I do believe that if that's the case, I believe that he could really do something with it. And so that's my take on that.
All right. Nate's take. Nathan LeDuc, Sun Devil Hall of Famer, good friend, and just a great guy. Nate, I look forward to part two when we talk to you again in a couple of weeks or next week, whenever you want to. Just let us know.
Okay, Vince, sounds good.
Nathan LeDuc, Nate, I am so excited. You know, there's other broadcasters that are scared of this guy because they feel threatened. I'm embracing it because I feel like it's going to raise the level that we bring. So, Nate, thanks again, and we'll talk to you soon.
Okay, all right. Take care.
All right. Nate LeDuc. All right, guys. We are live from the Phoenix Union High School District Sports Hall of Fame Golf Tournament here at Grand Canyon University Course, the site of the old Maryvale Golf Course at 59th Avenue and Indian School. Beautiful course that Grand Canyon University maintains. I'm joined by the executive director and also current district athletic director of Phoenix Union High School District, Dr. Zachary Munoz. Dr. Munoz, welcome. First of all, welcome to the show. And talk a little bit about this golf tournament and how it's benefiting current student athletes and how we're honoring past student athletes.
Thanks, Vince. The piece of building this from the ground up with our committee and having some great folks like Vince and others help us to develop this has kind of helped to naturally evolve what we're doing. The folks that we have researched and pulled from 1895 to now was no small task, and so their work has been invaluable to help us to find these great athletes that have come through from all of our schools that are still open, as well as the schools that have closed due to just aging out in regards to our district. The other thing that we're doing as part of this golf tournament and the evolution of this golf tournament to raise money for us is obviously to help us support our ceremony, but the other piece was to build a foundation and an endowment for scholarships. And at this point, we've given out about 144 scholarships and over $100,000 of money raised for our athletes, for our future Hall of Famers. Sure. So we're excited about that.
Man, when the people behind you told me to come to this hole to see some really bad golf.
Yeah.
Appreciate that. You weren't kidding.
Yeah, you're checking it out.
Wow.
35 years.
Yeah, well, this guy was a Baltimore Colt over here,
yeah.
I think.
Green Bay or Colt?
Yeah, Colt, right, Lynn?
Colt.
What? You were the Colts?
Baltimore.
Yeah, you played with Johnny U.
Yeah, correct.
All right.
Correct.
Good to see you, sir.
Thank you.
All right. Great. How is it playing with this guy over here, this Sowers guy?
I'll tell you what.
Are you carrying him today?
No. We are mutually attacking the course.
Yeah.
And he is holding up his end of the bargain.
Okay.
Well, I think reconnecting them with Phoenix Union and our foundation has been a key for getting them reconnected and re-energized with what we're doing in Phoenix Union. That work has been invaluable with what we've done and our work with the foundation, because one of their big mantras of our foundation, our district foundation, is to reconnect our alumni, and these folks that have come back through our Hall of Fame have continued to come back and continue to give back to us. I think the cool part too, like folks like Dwayne Evans and Byron Evans, who are both at South Mountain still coaching, and our inductees are folks like that have come back and taught for us, as well as you know, being alumni, and it really sends a message to our community how we value that.
Don't mind me, you guys. I was just sent out here to capture some really bad golf.
I was going to say, you're at the right hole.
Yeah. Man, that was bad. Who created all these divots in the ground?
Yeah, you know, we've been really fortunate, I guess, you know, being able to bring folks back and then have a lot of our companies that support us through athletics to come and support what we do here. They really value what we're doing. But some of the auctions items we're bringing in, we have an Arizona Cardinals football that was signed by Matt Prater. And I think he kicked the game winner last week to put them over the top. Yeah. We have a Mikhail Bridges autographed basketball. Y'all know who Mikhail is. He played on the team that made it to the World Championships with the Phoenix Suns. Mikhail's back. And then we also have a donation item from one of our families of inductees. The Bruniks had donated a couch. A recliner.
I thought I saw a signed 8x10 Vince DeLicio over there on the table, too. That might be one of the high bids today.
We were actually paying people to take that photo rather than the other way around.
I told the groups, a couple groups back, that I was looking for some really bad golf, and they pointed me in this direction. And I don't even know how this guy ended up here today, but this is, Wow, Dylan. Two clubs and everything, huh?
Well, I'm down to one. Second. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Carry on, guys. I don't want to interrupt anything you guys are doing.
Let's go find your balls.
Yeah. Apparently, those are missing somewhere. I don't know. Good luck there. Yeah. Thought maybe you left them at home before you came out here today. Thanks again for joining us, Dr. Zachary Munoz, Executive Director of the Phoenix Union Sports Hall of Fame Committee, and honoring current and past student athletes.
KDUS AM 1060 is the home to the Dan Patrick Show, the Doug Gottlieb Show, and Sports Map Radio.
Catch all the sports content here on AM 1060.
Hey, this is John Linton with the I Have a Name Project and Let's Be Better Humans. You're listening to the Varsity Sports Show.
This is Dylan, the star of It's Dylan on the Varsity Sports Show. Tune in Saturdays for It's Dylan.
Chris Scott of RE/MAX is Central Oregon's best realtor for anyone thinking of a vacation home or relocation. He's our very own, born and raised Venetian, who moved his family to Central Oregon nearly 15 years ago. Contact Chris if you're thinking of exploring beautiful Central Oregon. It truly is living at its best. 541-999-5614. Proud partner of the Varsity Sports Show's It's Dylan.
Hey, this is Derek Van Halen from Van Halen, the world's most authentic tribute to Van Halen. And you're listening to the Varsity Sports Show on AM 1060, Arizona.
Catch the Doug Gottlieb Show weekdays from 1 to 3 p.m. right here on KDUS AM 1060 and online at KDUS1060.com.
It's time for a reality check. This is the reality of reffing, where you can learn the X's and O's of football reffing on the Varsity Sports Show.
Hello, Varsity Sports fans. This is Jay Wilder Adams, and today I'm alongside Jake Gustafson, a football ref for the AIA. How are you doing, sir?
I'm doing good. How are you?
I'm fantastic. Thank you. Today, I just want to talk about, you know, the process of ejection. That is definitely a very controversial topic that is viewed very subjectively by a lot of fans. And I just want to ask you the first question. Could you explain the specific rules of ejection?
Most ejections happen due to a couple different things, either unsportsmanlike conduct or fighting. And unsportsmanlike conduct can be directed towards either other players or officials or other participants in the contest. Fighting is pretty obvious. If we have players throw punches, we do classify punches as opposed to slaps. If it's a punch, that's an automatic ejection. unsportsmanlike conduct. If a head coach receives two unsportsmanlike conduct fouls, it's an ejection. If a player receives two unsportsmanlike conduct fouls, it's an ejection. If an assistant coach receives one, it's an ejection for an assistant coach.
My next question to you is, in what scenario is it most difficult to determine whether it's an ejection or not?
It's really not all that difficult to determine whether it should be an ejection. We don't eject players and coaches, they eject themselves. So players and coaches are ejected due to behaviors that they exhibit on the field. So we just follow the rules and we give them flags for their unsportsmanlike behavior or their whatever they have done to deserve the penalty. Or if they are fighting, that's easy. So administering the ejection is, it's not hard because we just follow the rules and give them the penalties that they earn.
I love that reference. They eject themselves, that accountability factor. And my last question for you is, what is your best advice for players and coaches to avoid any scenario of ejection?
Best advice is treat officials with respect. I mean, treat us the way that you want us to treat you. Be professional towards officials the way that you expect us to be professional towards the coaches. Players, same exact thing. I mean, most unsportsmanlike conduct penalties happen because they get in the heat of the moment, the heat of the battle, and they lose their emotions. They forget where they're at. They forget how they're supposed to act. And when they forget how they're supposed to act, we penalize them. So treat officials, treat players the way that you wish that they would treat you on the field. That's the best advice I could give anybody on the field.
Absolutely. He is Jake Gustafson of AIA Football Referee. I'm Jay Wilder. See you guys next time.
This is Aliyah Harriet with the Varsity Sports Show, back with the WNBA report. The Las Vegas Aces are WNBA champions. The Aces have brought home the first major championship title to the city of Vegas. The Aces defeated the Connecticut Sun in Game 4 of the WNBA Finals 78-71 to take the series. Alyssa Thomas for the Sun recorded her second consecutive triple-double, but that would not be enough for Connecticut. The Aces had too much star power. Chelsea Gregg continued her amazing run in the playoffs, putting up 20 points. The big storyline for the Aces will be Raquana Williams coming off the bench and scoring 17 points for the team. The players could not have completed what they did without an incredible coaching staff. Head coach Becky Hammon was an assistant to Greg Popovich in the NBA before making the move to the WNBA. She became the first coach to win the title in her inaugural season. The Aces had a historic season, losing just 10 games throughout the year. Asia Wilson won MVP and Defensive Player of the Year for the 2022 season, and Chelsea Gray was named Finals MVP. The Las Vegas Strip was flooded with Aces fans to celebrate the champions in a parade. With the Aces returning many of their key players next year, will they be able to repeat? This has been a WNBA report with Aliyah Harriet.
Nobody pray for me. It been a day for me.
Welcome to the Wolves Recap with Desert Mountain football coach Conrad Hamilton.
All right, here with Desert Mountain coach Hamilton after the game. It was 23-0 at one point, came down to the wire at the end of the game. What were your thoughts on how that second half went and as it came down to the wire?
Yeah, you know, first of all, we're pleased. We're pleased to be able to come over here and complete and get the opportunity to play against some of the best in the state of Arizona, right? You know, I played many times on this field, calling calls from that particular sideline, you know what I mean? So it was special to be back over here. And, you know, this team, they played in the championship last year and won it the year before. You know, we came out hot. We're a better team than I do believe than they are this year. We have a lot of returning guys. They lost a lot of guys from last year, so they're kind of retooling a little bit. We're proud of our efforts early on, but, again, that really shouldn't have been a game, right? It's 23-0. We threw two picks. You know, we stalled in certain areas of the field. We turned the ball over twice on fumbles in their territory, so we could have really put the game out of reach in the first half. But, again, we did what we did at Mountain View last week. We start strong, then we turn the ball over and do some things or whatever so we don't kind of put guys away. But, you know, they're a heart of a champion over there. Coach Barnes is an excellent coach. He went back in, figured out what we were doing to them on defense a little bit, and started chucking the ball deep and doing some stuff. And then when the game got close, just like in high school does, these things only happen in high school. Guys get tight. Guys get nervous. Guys don't execute at a high level. And that's really all you see right there at the end of the game, whatever it is. Guys that are worried about making mistakes instead of executing at a high level and playing like a professional. And they're only high school kids, so that comes. I know I'm tough on them, but, you know, good win for our program regardless. We didn't necessarily finish the way we want, but that's why we practice. They're high school kids. We got to get back to the grind or whatever and get them to improve on some of the things that we're not doing excellent.
And having a lot of guys that play on both sides of the ball, how does that come into play in a game like this?
Just conditioning. I mean, you saw it. Four guys cramping there at the end. We're substituting guys that don't much already as it is in critical situations, playing for us at the end. So we got to condition more. But then we got to figure out how to take care of our bodies during the week, you know, because we play guys both ways. We're only two deep at every position, you know. We don't have a junior varsity. We only have two programs. So that is like the balance that's burden on me, basically, to figure out how we practice, what we do in practice to get us to prepare for the games. And then, you know, strength staff, what we're doing there, and then what we're doing with our medical staff and training room to get guys, you know, to not cramp and be ready to play on these days. So those are all things that I'll have to evaluate. Yep.
So what's the most important thing heading into next week you're going to take a look at?
I just think right now, whatever is the highs and lows. We had two dramatic finishes over the last couple of weeks. 6A programs, right? We beat two 6A programs with 30 guys, basically. All right? We have a great junior class of kids. We have a bunch of seniors that chomp and play. We play aggressive defense, and we're multiple on offense. So I think we haven't even hit our stride yet. I really do, and I know that people are like, come on, coach, you're 4-0, you beat two back-to-back 6A teams. But we have it. And, you know, if we execute, all right, continuously, whatever, I think we'll continue to get better week to week. We got, I don't know what Arcadia did, but I know they were undefeated prior to tonight, and then Notre Dame's one of the better teams that we're going to face as well. So we'll see.
All right, thanks for your time, coach. Congrats on the win.
Hey. You ready?
You are listening to the home of Canyon View Jaguar football, the Jag Nation, on the Varsity Sports Show, AM 1060 KDUS, Arizona. And now, here's Coach Nick Garrett.
Is you ready? Huh? Are you ready?
Ready?
Is you ready? Whole squad ready. We came here to see Jet. What you got?
Stowe Safaropoulos here with the Varsity Sports Show. I'm with Canyon View head coach Nick Garrett. And coach, you guys have had back-to-back shutouts the last two games. And Bo Devins has really looked like he has got a lot more games under his belt and experience. How has his game just developed these past few weeks?
Yeah, man, our defense is playing lights out right now. They're flying to the ball like we talked about earlier in the pregame. And I'm really proud of those guys. And Coach Hull and our defense staff does a really good job. And Bo, like you said, Bo is looking a lot more comfortable. And I think that really shows, and he's just going to continue to grow in the offense as the season progresses.
Yeah, and you guys had a great game tonight, but you guys also struggled to score in the second half like you have a lot this season. How do you plan to change that?
We got to quit having stupid penalties. We go from third and short to third and long, and that's really hard to recover from. So it's just we got to rep it in practice and not kick ourselves in the foot, you know. We just got to keep fighting.
Thank you, Coach.
All right, thanks, guys.
This is Stowe Safaropoulos from the Varsity Sports Show.
Welcome back to the Varsity Sports Show. I'm Stowe Safaropoulos, and today I'm going to be giving you guys your Arizona Cardinals report. The Cardinals struggled in the season opener against the Kansas City Chiefs, losing 44-21, and it looked like those struggles were going to carry into Week 2 as they were losing to the Raiders 23-7 heading into the fourth quarter. A early fourth quarter one-yard rushing touchdown by Darrell Williams and a Kyler Murray two-point conversion run put the Cardinals within 8 points of the Raiders. On the final play of regulation, Kyler Murray scored a three-yard touchdown to put them within 2 points of the Raiders. On a two-point conversion, Kyler Murray was able to find A.J. Green in the back of the end zone to give the Cardinals new life heading into overtime. Cardinals corner Byron Murphy Jr. made a huge play for the Cardinals in overtime as he had a 59-yard fumble recovery touchdown sealing the game for Arizona. This game was a great step in the right direction for the Cardinals, especially after a tough loss in Week 1 against the Kansas City Chiefs. Being able to rally back all the way against Las Vegas is a huge win, especially when fans were popping champagne at halftime. Heading off with a big win against the Las Vegas Raiders, tomorrow the Cardinals play the defending Super Bowl champs, the Los Angeles Rams. This is Stowe Safaropoulos sending it back to the Varsity Sports Show studio.
Interact with Bob Kemp's poll question on KDUS1060.com. That's KDUS1060.com. And while you're there, check out Bob Kemp's bottom line at KDUS1060.com.
Hi, this is Mike from Beachin' with Beal, and you're listening to the Varsity Sports Show.
Hey guys, Vince here to talk about Angel Dentistry. It's where my wife and I have gone for over 10 years, and we trust them with our routine and extensive dental care because they care. Dr. Amber Angel is an Arizona native, born in the town of Miami, and has been practicing in the Valley over 20 years. For general to comprehensive dental services, call 602-788-2008. Located off of Cave Creek Road, just north of the 101 in North Phoenix, Angel Dentistry, proud supporters of our young people and proud partners of the Varsity Sports Show.
This is Coach Lucas Ramirez, and you are listening to the home of the Saguaro Sabercats, the Varsity Sports Show, on AM 1060 KDUS.
Founder-level sponsors, the Kristen Graziano Group with HomeSmart Elite, are proud to be Saguaro alumni, community advocates, and your hometown realtors. The Kristen Graziano Group is ranked in the top 1.5% of real estate teams nationally, and your top-selling team right here in Sabercat territory. The Kristen Graziano Group can currently be seen on the Emmy-nominated TV show Selling the Valley of the Sun. When you're ready to buy, sell, or want to know the value of your home, reach out to the group that knows the neighborhood, the Kristen Graziano Group.
Every Monday night, check out Ray Adams as he hosts the Monday Night Golf and Lifestyle Show from 6 to 7 p.m. here on KDUS AM 1060.
Hold up. Whoa, 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 whoa.
This is the Sabercat Report with Saguaro Sabercat football coach Jason Mons on the Varsity Sports Show AM 1060 KDUS Arizona. And now, here's Coach Mons.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Varsity Sports Show. I'm one of your hosts, Dylan denDekker, joined with Noelle and Vince. Well, we're here at the Sabercat Report. Coach Jason Mons, how you doing this morning?
I'm doing well. How are you guys?
We're doing excellent. Obviously, you had a tough loss last night. What can we see from the Sabercats to grow? Next week, next Friday, you're playing Liberty. It's a big game. Where are you going to grow from here now?
Yeah, we just got to do a better job of, you know, when we face adversity, when we have momentum swings, of just settling in and continuing to play our game. I think, you know, we started out really strong. We were having a lot of success, playing great defense, and we were moving the ball. First three possessions, we went up and down the field. You know, first possession, we had an interception, but we got a stop and got it back and then scored on our next two. But when they hit a big play, when we had some calls go against us, like really costly down and distance situations where some penalties kept their drives alive, and then they hit a big play, we just didn't respond well to the momentum swing, and we got a little flustered, and we started making uncharacteristic mistakes, and it just really, really kind of shot ourselves in the foot, and you can't do that against great teams. So we just need to get better at weathering the storm. We're playing, you know, not just good teams. We're playing great teams pretty much every week on our schedule, and great teams are gonna make plays. The momentum is gonna swing, and we've got to just do a better job of understanding that, and not getting too high and not getting too low.
Coach, hey, Coach Vince here. A question for you. So, and you had addressed that point in the game in the second quarter with you had that costly penalty, and then the play resulting was that long touchdown pass to number three. What was the message at halftime? What was the tone at halftime when you went in and you talked to the guys and started looking at making those adjustments? How did that go?
Yeah, I mean, it was just a normal halftime. I mean, we were up 14-10. I mean, we felt like we were in a good spot. We had the ball to start and put ourselves in a good position. We just didn't convert. We had our first two offensive possessions the second half. We had third and one or third and two, and we just missed opportunities. I mean, it wasn't they didn't stop us. We stopped ourselves, and so I mean, I felt like we you know, were feeling like we were in a good spot. And but we've got to move the chains, and we got to get some momentum going. I think we only ran seven plays in the third quarter. You know, they had some big long drives. They were running the ball and leaning on their big O line, and we've got to be able to keep some drives alive, keep our defense off the field. And I think if we could have come out and you know, gone down and punched it in, you know, but it's just we kind of started pressing a little bit, Vince, and you know, you can't do that against a good team. If you start pressing and you start hesitating and playing afraid, you know, then they go on a big run like they did. And it just took us too long to settle back in.
When I was conferring with our analyst, Elia Harriet, last night on the waning moments of the game, you know, I asked her, you know, who's on your short list for player of the game? Who's your player of the game? And she pointed out, we called his name a lot throughout the game. Trey Morrison was our player of the game last night. Talk about Trey.
Trey's a stud. I mean, he's absolutely playing his heart out for our team. He's getting confidence. You know, he's only a junior. He's the younger brother of the two Sully brothers that are the, you know, starting linebackers at Arizona State. So obviously he comes from a great bloodline of terrific Saguaro football players, but he's just getting better every week, and he's starting to play with a lot of passion and fire, and you know, we're really proud of him. But he's given us everything he got. I mean, he's when you talk about what Saguaro football is supposed to look like, the way he plays, that's what it looks like.
Yeah, he plays with reckless abandon. He's a great linebacker. Noelle, you had a question for Coach. Go ahead.
Hi, Coach. Noelle Blumel here. Kind of going back to your point of trying to keep the team retained and zoned in those times of momentum shifters, what is your approach as a coach to instill that mental toughness and kind of working that mental side off the field within your team?
Yeah, I mean, I think we got to create competitive situations in practice. You know, we do a lot of competitive periods where we go, you know, good on good, and we do, you know, red zone periods and third down periods, and we do 2-minute drills, and we try to create a competitive, you know, environment in practice and put those guys in stressful situations as much as possible. And sometimes, you know, honestly, it's just you got to go through those experiences. It's like, you know, it's real life experiences. Sometimes you don't know how to handle something well until you go through it and you handle it the wrong way. And then the next time you're in it, you know, you need to do it better. So that's why it's week four. That's why we said the gold ball wasn't going home last night. You know, you're playing great teams early. I mean, we've got two losses that to teams that are both ranked in the national top 10, you know, in the country. And so, like, you know, we're not feeling too bad about ourselves right now. Like, obviously we're disappointed. We felt like we missed a great opportunity last night. I think we had them right where we wanted them. We kind of felt like they were who we thought they were, to quote, Dennis Green. But you know, it's a great learning opportunity for us. And I think, you know, hopefully if we take care of our business and get another shot at them, I think we'll have a little bit more for them next time.
Going into your leadership style, how much do you rely on your seniors from when they start the program as a freshman? Where does the seniors take in the leadership?
Well, I mean, we have a saying that bad teams have no leadership. Good teams are coach-led and great teams are player-led. And the best teams we've had here have not always been the most talented ones. They're usually the ones that have the best leadership. And you know, obviously it starts with the seniors, but it's not exclusive to seniors. It's really, you know, anybody can lead. But you got to lead by example. You got to lead with passion. And to be honest with you, I don't think we have bad leadership, but we don't have championship caliber leadership yet. And we didn't this time last year either, you know. And it's funny because you look back, we were kind of, you know, as a coaching staff, kind of hemming and hawing about we need more leadership with the team we had last year. And by the end of it, we were like, man, that's one of the best, you know, led teams we've ever had. So it's a growing process. You know, these are, you know, 15, 16, 17 year old young men that are, they weren't in that role last year as leaders. We had seniors that took that role, and now they're trying to define their roles as leaders on this team, and guys are rising up, and some guys, you know, unfortunately, that we kind of thought we could count on haven't stepped up to the challenge yet. So we got to keep challenging them, and this, they'll figure it out. I mean, this is a proud program. We're going to keep working. We worked our butt off last week to prepare ourselves for that game, and we're not going to change that. We're going to keep grinding. We're going to keep looking at ourselves. We're going to keep evaluating. We know we're not where we need to be, but we've had some pretty damn good, you know, looks at who we are and where we need to go from some really high caliber opponents. So we're going to figure this thing out and keep plugging away.
All right. Coach Jason Mond, Sabercat Report. Coach, good luck next week. Thanks so much for the opportunity.
All right. Thanks, guys.
Good morning, Varsity sports fans. This is Jay Wilder, and today I'm alongside the state leader five games through the season and rushing sophomore Sam Webb of Gilbert Christian High School, the Knights. How's it going, Sam?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic. You've had an amazing season thus far. 877 yards through five games. That is absolutely remarkable. My first question to you is, you're a sophomore this year, which is even crazier. Yeah. What has led to such a substantial leap this year?
Ever since the summer, we've been working out really hard. Even before end of the freshman year, fourth quarter, we've been working so hard, and the linemen have been working so hard to make me be able to get to this point with rushing yards and all this. My coaches have led me to this spot, and yeah, I owe it to my teammates and coaches.
You're this productive and you're crediting everybody else around you, man. That is just awesome maturity. And my next question to you is, because you've been this productive throughout the season thus far, do you ever think about just like how defenses plan for you going into each night?
Well, we do have a very good wide receiver core. We have a freshman, Bennett Juve, who is and all just a superstar, and they have to key on him sometimes, and they got to key on me. So like, sometimes it's tough to make a game plan before the game, but we just do what we do.
Yeah, you got to pick your poison, right?
Yeah.
You have the receiver, the running back. My last question to you is, this could be about you, your team, everybody, really. What are your goals this year, and what are your team's goals?
So last year, we were the region champions, and we won the first round, and we lost in the quarterfinals to Wilcox, who went on to lose in the state championship. But our goal this year is to definitely win the championship, because it's our last year in 2A, and next year we're moving up to 3A. And our goal is to definitely win the region, which starts this week, and make it all through playoffs. And the end goal is to win a championship.
I want to ask you one quick question, if that's okay with you. One last one. How do you guys feel about moving into 3A next year?
We're excited. We actually just finished a three-game span of playing 3A teams, and we went 2-1 from that. And we're ready. We have some talent, young talent, and we're ready for that.
It sounds like you're ready. He is Sam Webb of Gilbert Christian High School. I'm Jay Wilder of Varsity Sports Show. See you guys soon.
Thank you so much, Jay Wilder. Well, let's talk a little about ASU, since we are both ASU students here. Coming back today, 5 p.m., we're going to have the Sun Devil Walk, a tradition that really hasn't been around too long here at ASU. But similar to the SEC, players are going to be able to walk out before the stadium. It's going to start at the Desert Financial Arena, and it'll go all the way to the Sun Devil Way. What do you think about this, Noelle?
Yeah, no, I think it honestly couldn't have come at a better time, obviously, with all the changes we've had in the Valley this past week, and just kind of seeing how the last game against Eastern Michigan played out. I think there's just a lot of uncertainty, and I think traditions like this, and I think something that Coach Iguana really emphasizes is his theme of Ohana and like the family aspect of it. And I think in times like these, when change come up, the only thing you have is, you know, not to sound cliche, but is each other. And I think to come together as a student body, as a Sun Devil Nation, especially with high stakes of this game, you know, Utah defending conference champions and just being the Pac-12 opener, I think it's great timing to do, to bring everybody together.
Yeah, for a team like Utah, it's going to be a hard battle for ASU, since, you know, they are ranked, Utah that is. But going a little bit more into detail about this ASU Sun Devil Walk, for those of you who don't know, it's a walk of the athletes, so it'll be going from the Desert Financial Arena in Tempe, Arizona. It's going to be going to the stadium. It's going to be starting at 5 p.m. I think this is a great way for Iguana to kind of get the fans really involved. A problem that ASU's kind of been having is by halftime, half the fans are gone, or there's a battle between the fans. And for a team to be successful, they need their fans to be there. And the Sun Devil Nation, I believe, is going to be there, and they're going to show out tonight. Their motto is, you know, onward to victory, and kind of rolling with the punches here. And even Sun Devil Athletic and Sun Devil football, especially on Twitter, has been very active. Coach Sean Iguana has been active on Twitter, and I think that's something we haven't really seen in the past few years. What do you think?
Yeah, no, definitely. And I think another theme that's going on tonight is the blackout. I think our team's going to be wearing their black jerseys tonight. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think they're advising or encouraging the fans to wear that as well. And I think it just goes back to that. It really is, you know, just in this one week of interim head coach Sean Iguana just showing his theme of family coming together, you know, matching with the players and doing this walk. I think you had mentioned before it's a tradition in the SEC. Is that accurate?
SEC, yeah.
Yeah. So I think just in, you know, obviously big conference, very successful, so many teams out there. And I think implementing that into the Pac-12, and especially with Sun Devil Nation, with everything that's been happening, it's going to prove to be very encouraging and a positive for the team to bring everybody back together after this chaotic week. So
maybe it's just me as a fan, but I think ASU upsets Utah and wins. Kind of like they did not too long ago.
Right.
My first game that I went to ASU, it was a blackout against Michigan State. And that's when we won.
Okay.
So I definitely think that ASU has a chance under new head coach, under the leaders of their seniors. So I'm excited to see tonight's game.
Yep. Tonight at 7:30, Sun Devil Nation.
All right, guys, when we come back from the break, nice job there. We are going to be joined by my old friend Mike Beal with the Beachin' with Beal Southern California Surfing Report. Hopefully he's got a good report for us from SoCal, Costa Mesa, Huntington Beach. He hangs out on the Huntington Pier.
That's my place.
Yep. We'll be back. Go Varsity.
Check out KDUS AM 1060 on 100.7 KSLX HD2. That's right, HD Radio on 100.7 channel number 2.
Hey guys, Vince here to talk to you about a good friend of mine named Bob Jenkins. Bob is a Marine Corps veteran. Bob and his younger brother DJ own Vets Built Contracting. You've seen their trucks around Metro Phoenix, I'm sure. For 5 years, they've been hiring and putting veterans to work. Vets Built is licensed, bonded, and insured, both residential and commercial, specializing in renovations, remodeling, new build, casitas, safe rooms, or small commercial TI work. If you're a skilled veteran looking for work, a homeowner in need of work, or a commercial business needing TI work, please call Bob or DJ at Vets Built at 480-584-3675.
Hey, local businesses, join the Varsity Sports Show and promote your business on our weekly radio show and game live streams. We have several options to promote your business affordably and reach our incredible audience. Call, text, or email us anytime if you'd like more information on joining our team. The Varsity Sports Show will work hard to promote your business through our audio and video platforms while also promoting all of our young people. 480-779-9437 or email us at varsitysportsshow.com. In 2019, the JV Sports Show podcast began with the idea of spotlighting young people in our community. In time, that podcast evolved into radio, television, and live stream, and through that evolution, new ideas have enhanced delivery, giving a stage to students both in front of and behind the microphone in Arizona and beyond. Thank you for supporting the Varsity Sports Show, now the Varsity Media Foundation, a 501c3 educational organization.
Hi, this is Rob Maggs, Vince's life coach and surfing coach to the Beach Bum Beal. You're listening live to the Varsity Sports Show on AM 1060 KDUS.
HD Radio is here for KDUS AM 1060. Check out your favorite shows and games on 100.7 KSLX HD2.
And now it's time for Beachin' with Beal. Random thoughts from a real Orange County, California surfer guy, Mike Beal. The opinions expressed during this segment in no way represent those of KDUS AM 1060 Arizona, the Varsity Sports Show, its host, or its listeners.
Show AM 1060. This is Beachin' with Beal, and today we have none other. This is Varsity Sports Show AM 1060. Beachin'
sorry
with Beal.
About
we
that,
have
Noelle.
Mike Beal.
I didn't
today.
Prepare you for that. So my friend Mike spent the week in Mexico, and that was kind of, I threw that in there as just to, you know, to kind of set it up with a little bit of flavor. So, Mike, are you there?
Buen dia, amigas. ¿Cómo están?
Bien. This is so ridiculous. So I'm working with our wonderful, talented staff here. We've got Dylan and Noelle in studio today, and I'm sure you saw the promo for this week. But I tried talking to them a little bit about what this segment is about. Noelle, what did I tell you about this segment when we were at commercial break? Because you wanted to know, what's this about? How do I prep for this?
The first half was just an overview, kind of surfing and, you know, Orange County native. And then the second half was kind of a little bit of banter.
Be specific, though. What kind of banter? You could say it. It's fine.
From what I understand, it's Mike bantering at Vince.
Yeah, so, insulting me.
No. I'm trying to coach Vince up. I want him to succeed, in life. Like, for example, I'm on the Vincipalooza World Surf Tour right now on 56th Street. It's the 56th Street Surf Contest put on by the city of Newport Beach. And I just found out there's an open girls division, so all ages. So yeah. I was thinking,
so is that for me? Yeah.
Well, yeah, I was thinking next year it could be like a goal of yours, maybe to compete. Yeah. And then I think in the contest itself, your goal should be second to last place, so that you don't get last place.
Thanks.
If you enter.
All right. So we're going to, you're going to get called to the mat here because Dylan is from Huntington Beach. So he can spot a liar from a mile away.
Oh, so,
yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Those are some strong words.
Yeah.
Hey, what's up, Dylan? What can I do for you, buddy?
How are we doing? How's the swell today?
It's a little small. You know, for a surf contest, it's a little junky. The tide's a little high, so it's not a lot of power here. 56th Street's a good spot. There's always something, and the guys are surfing off the jetty, and they're doing a pretty good job. It's the kids, or what we call groms, when you're 51 and 5'6" years old, but they're making the most of it.
And Noelle is from Santa Clarita, site of National Lampoon's Vacation, Wally World. So, Noelle, do you have any questions for this guy?
Yes, I am from Santa Clarita, but I go to Orange County every time I go home. The beaches are incredible, a lot better than LA beaches. I don't know your thoughts on that, but
I agree. Yeah. What's your favorite beach in Orange County?
I love going to Huntington, even though it's a touristy a little bit. I also Dylan and I were just talking before the show about Pelican Hill and Crystal Cove over there down in Newport, which is just absolutely beautiful. But I have to say that. What's your favorite?
I'm partial to Newport myself. Yeah. Everything from the river jetty on down to Balboa Pier, including it used to be the Wedge when I was younger, but nowadays I've just been surfing Blackies mostly at Newport Pier.
Yeah, definitely. But,
it's funny you mentioned Crystal Cove, though. I was just thinking about that the other day. That was the only time I almost got rescued by a lifeguard. I was out there on a kind of substantial day and I got caught in a rip. I was about 12 and the lifeguard swam out there. I was with my cousin.
David Hasselhoff?
I wish, but no, it was Pamela Anderson. Right. And so swam out there and said, "Are you okay?" And
I was like, high water, wasn't it? What was it?
And my floaty actually separated from my body. So it was a very frightening experience, Crystal Cove.
So what lessons do you have for us today? Because you've been on this Vincipalooza world tour, as you called it, and getting different surf spots. And is that your wife in the background nagging you to get off the phone, or what?
Lesson for today. Okay, so the lesson for you, Vince, is if I came to this surf contest with you this morning, I would suggest that you put a bag over your head and not take it off, because this is prime time stand kicking in the face. But I did, in one of the stands, I did see a pie.
Yeah.
Someone, and I could just vividly picture someone throwing it directly into your face.
Yeah, and then proceeding to kick sand all over me. Yeah. That's even better than I thought. My staff are angry at you right now. They're making these gestures saying they're coming after you because you've taken the gloves off with me, apparently. So
no, I think they're imagining wrapping your mouth in duct tape so that you are unable to speak. That's what I think they're thinking.
That's not very nice. So, all right.
That's not nice.
So we went from a Vincipalooza surf tour now to insults, and I think maybe Dylan has another question for you. Go ahead, Dylan.
Okay.
Yeah. Save the show, Dylan.
Hey, Mike. a lot of people don't understand the competitiveness within the kind of the sport of surfing. Can you kind of talk about, especially in Newport, I know there's a lot of kind of ambition, and people do yell at each other when in the water, and it's sometimes cannot be a friendly sport, like kind of most sports. Can you kind of elaborate on what do you think of kind of domination of within Newport, within Huntington, and even Laguna?
I can. That is actually an excellent question, Dylan. Thank you. It is competitive. And the reason why is because there's not enough waves to go around. So as you could probably imagine, everyone concentrates on the good spots, such as what comes to my mind, because I can't surf there anymore because I'm not young and competitive, is Huntington Beach Pier. So, for example, at the pier, there's one wave on either side, typically, and usually the entire Huntington Beach High School surf team is on it. So you can imagine that kind of up and down the coast, everybody's looking for that one perfect wave, but it's all the time. So you have to be quite aggressive to get waves. And as I got older, I quit going to Huntington Beach Pier because I didn't get any waves. It's not that I wasn't aggressive enough. I just wasn't, energetic. I couldn't keep up with the kids anymore. So, but yeah, that is the reason why it's there's not enough waves to go around, essentially. And then, you know, there's always some hotheads in the water, like on the freeway, you know, you cut them off. They're like, hey, so it's pretty much like that.
Definitely, Mike. Thank you for your input on that. But I also have to ask, so me being a California native, I have never surfed in my whole life, and I am now 20 years old. And, you know, it's a little intimidating because it seems like it's obviously comes much easier to people who start out from when they were younger. So what advice would you give to a surfer, you know, around my age who's never gone out before that just kind of wants to experience it for the first time?
Yeah, like when I went out the one time, remember?
I do.
You want to describe that event and then go into some actual constructive, advice?
I will. So I took Vince out about 23 years ago, right down the street from where I am currently at the 56th Street Surf Contest. And Vince didn't have the most wonderful experience because it was kind of big. It was definitely not a rookie spot. So he obviously got worked. And I mean, you know, he came into shore, got some sand kicked in his face, the whole nine. But anyway, for a real, you know, if I really wanted to take somebody out surfing, it's all about where, typically. Like, if you can imagine Waikiki Beach in Hawaii, nice, slow, friendly waves. Almost anybody can get one with a big board. And so the equivalent to that here would actually be Newport Beach Pier on the south side. The waves are a little friendlier, a little slower. The paddle out's not too tough. And so it's kind of all about the first experience. If you have a bad one your first time, you probably aren't coming back. But if you get even a glimmer of hope, you know, you get up on a big board, maybe catch a wave, you could be hooked. And so it's kind of all comes down to your first couple of experiences, if you enjoyed it or not. It's like, over the years, it's like 50-50. I've taken a lot of people out. Some people loved it. You know, they're hooked. Other people probably never wanted to get in the ocean again. So I think it's definitely the environment, which, unfortunately, you cannot control at the beach.
Mike, I'm going to have to call you out on that. I don't know if Newport Pier is the best place to start. Personally, I would take myself and I go 30 minutes south, and I'd probably go to San Onofre or even San Clemente, just because those waves are, A, a little smaller, are also slower, and B, there's less people down there. I mean, Sano is going to be real competitive, but it's still a great place to go.
You continue to impress.
So he one-upped you, Mike, and on that note, we have to end the show. So thank you so much. Yes, yep.
I don't ever want this to end. Sorry. I love you guys.
Yeah, whatever. All right. Guys, thanks again for joining us. Thanks to our wonderful guests, our show partners. Thanks for an amazing show. Dylan, Noelle, in 5 seconds, what could you say about the show?
Just keep watching what we're doing. We're going up.
Yep. Great opportunity. I've loved every second. It's
been
awesome.
All right. Thanks, you guys. We'll see you. Actually, we got a couple games tonight. NYS tonight and HJCAC. Tune in, guys. A lot of fun. We'll see you. And then tomorrow night, Varsity Weekly, NFHS channel, 8 p.m. We'll see you next week. Same varsity time, same varsity station, 8 to 10, Saturday morning. This is Vince, Varsity Sports Show, out.
Thank you for listening to the Varsity Sports Show.